Pew, pew, pew.
Oh, hey, you catch me playing with my toy tanks. Do you want to see them? They're pretty cool.
What?
What do you mean, that one? That's not a tank. That's just my fridge. Wait. What?
Oh!
The kv2, also known online as the Soviet fridge, is something that you get when you ask a 7-year-old to draw a tank. So what is this monstrosity? How did it came to be? And what purpose did it serve? To find that out, we need to go back to 1939, at the Winter War. Now, I'm not gonna go too deep into the Winter War, because we're here to laugh at the tank design, not to laugh at the incompetency of the Soviets. But let me summarize it quickly for you. The Soviets wanted a part of Finland to secure their border, and the Finns didn't really want to give up much of their land.
No.
So the Soviets invaded. Despite superior military strength, especially with tanks and aircraft, the Soviet Union was having, let's just say, a hard time dealing with the Finns. The Finns would set up ambushes for the unprepared Soviets, they would blow up trees, blocking the road, seeming to appear out of nowhere and start to shoot and throw Molotov cocktails at the Soviets. It also didn't help the Soviets much that they were still wearing their brown uniforms, you know, in a war called the Winter War, in Finland. And it became even harder for the Soviets when they encountered Finnish bunkers at the Mannerheim line. The Soviet commanders determined that they would need a tank with a thicker armor and a bigger cannon to break through these lines and destroy these bunkers. They would also need it as fast as possible, seeing that the whole world was watching one of the biggest armies in the world getting their teeth get kicked in by a country without a professional army.
Stop! He's already dead!
So the Soviet engineers went to work, and the first tank that they came up with was the Su-100Y. With a massive 130mm cannon that, I'm not joking, this thing was never meant for a tank, this thing was meant to be on a ship. In fact, that's how they got it. They got a few of these cannons from the Navy to experiment with, that's what they came up with, just plop it into a tank. This design was quickly rejected when the Navy saw what they were doing with the cannons, and they just refused to give any more cannons. And I mean, just look at this thing, can you really blame them? With a short deadline, and Stalin already pointing to the closest gulag, they came up with a brilliant idea. Just take the bottom of a KV-1 and slap a 152mm howitzer on it, and just call it a day. And with those plans done, they frantically started to build the prototypes, and it took them around 2 weeks to finish them. After that, quickly test them, and then send them off to the front line for further combat testing. Again, these things were fresh out of the oven. Maybe 2 weeks ago, they were still on paper, and now they're already in the front lines in Finland. And they performed pretty good! Nothing that the Finns had could really touch the KV-2, so it was a great success, and it was right on time for Operation Barbarossa. Now, we all know how effective the German army was at the start of the invasion of the Soviet Union, but just to give you some perspective of how bad things really were for the Soviet Union at the start of this war, in Ukraine alone, the German army destroyed 2,600 Soviet tanks in 3 weeks' time, while only losing a few hundred tanks themselves. This was for a few reasons, like bad tactics, subpar maintenance, but also like outdated tanks. They had old tanks that were just not up to the task anymore. However, the Soviets did have a handful of KV-2s, and just like the Finns, the Germans didn't have much. They did have a few things that could deal with this tank, but not very many things that could deal with this thing. I mean, let's just look at what the Germans could do. You see one of these KV-2s, what can you do? Use one of our own tanks to destroy it or disable it? You can't do that, you cannot get close because the cannon is better, it has a better range, and it will basically destroy every tank that you have in one hit. Use anti-tank weapons, you cannot really get that close to be effective. I mean, the rounds will just bounce off the armor, or you really have to get that close, but that's gonna be a suicide mission. The only things that the Germans could really do was use their heavy artillery, or they could use their famous 88mm flak gun. So every time that the Germans would encounter one of these tanks on the battlefield, it would be a huge headache to deal with it. One of the more famous encounters that the Germans had with this tank was in Raseiniai, where one well-placed kv2 stopped the German advance for an entire day. The tank was placed on a really important road that the Germans needed to take to advance. Now the Germans thought they already took this road, so the supply trucks were moving up to it. And that was the first victim of this kv2, or the column of German supply trucks. When the Germans got wind of this lone tank, they tried to destroy it or disable it by using 450mm anti-tank guns. The tank was hit multiple times, but all the shots just bounced off, and when the kv2 shot back, it destroyed all four of the guns. The Germans then said, screw it, let's get our flak 88, that will do the trick. But before they could even set it up, the kv2 destroyed that as well. Probably very annoyed, the Germans then waited for the night for combat engineers to get a little bit closer and destroy the tank with central charges. And even though they were convinced that this would do the trick, it didn't even damage the tank. So they said, fuck it, we will just throw everything what we have at this thing to just destroy it. In the morning, multiple German tanks started to shoot at the kv2 from a forest nearby, and another flak 88 was pulled up to finish the job. And this time, with all the firepower, they managed to score two hits that pierced through the armor. So, success! But when the German infantry approached the vehicle, the machine gun of the KV-2 started to fire on them. Eventually, they did manage to destroy this tank by throwing grenades through the hatch, but it took so much effort and it just delayed them an entire day. And in real, that was the perfect demonstration to show how dummy thick the armor of the KV-2 was. And what a danger the cannon posed for the German army. Now, after hearing all of that, you might think, well, if the Soviets had more of these tanks, the Germans would have never gone this far in their campaign. But no, even though this tank performed extremely well in certain situations, it just had way too many downsides. First of all, it was heavy, like really heavy, around 53 tons, which made it slow. Which is not ideal if you're fighting an enemy that is on the move constantly. Besides that, the comically oversized top part made it also top heavy, which resulted in the tank falling over every so often. Oh, and talking about the top part, to turn this cannon, you had to do it manually. So I hope that your enemies are right in front of you, because turning this thing was an absolute nightmare, and meant it was a struggle for even the strongest Soviet soldiers. There was also no radio on board, so good luck trying to communicate and coordinate an attack. Then there were things that were not the fault of the tank, but it didn't help it much. Like for example, it was a brand new tank, but there were no spare parts. The crews most of the time had very little training, so most of them had no clue what they were doing. And probably worst of all, in some extreme cases, the crews didn't even get 52mm rounds for their cannons. So they had this huge tank with this really thick armor, and the only thing that they could use on it to fight the enemies were their machine guns. It also didn't help much that this thing was designed to destroy bunkers, and when you're on defensive war, you're not destroying a lot of bunkers. So in most situations, these things performed fairly poorly. Couple that with all the design flaws, and you get why the Soviets didn't build more of these KV-2s. Instead of that, they preferred to build more modern tanks like the T-34, and by the end of 1942, almost all KV-2s were destroyed or were beyond repair. Sadly, there's only one KV-2 that survived till this day, and it's now on display on a military museum in Moscow. Thank you so much for watching. If you did enjoy this kind of content, I would really appreciate it if you could leave a like or a comment. It really helps me out. And if you want to see more content like this, then please hit subscribe.